So Jesus was a carpenter, but is that actually the best translation for what his family trade was? Well, we'll find out here in part 6 of Rabbis and Disciples. If after watching this teaching you find it helpful, like this video, subscribe to our channel, and share it with someone you think could benefit from it. All right, let's dive in and see what else we can learn about Jesus and his world. In the culture of Jesus' day, one was not allowed to receive payment for the teaching of God's word. I kid you not. Check out one of the many references you have in Jewish literature. This one is from the Mishnah, Perkei Avot, the Sayings or the Ethics of the Fathers, 527. Rabbi Zadok said, "Do not make the words of Torah a crown for self-exaltation, nor a spade with which to dig." So too Hillel used to say, "And he that puts the crown to his own use shall perish." Thus you have learned anyone who derives worldly benefit from the words of the Torah removes his life from the world. Whoo-wee! Those are some intense words around not receiving payment for God's words. So here's what we know about Jesus and the rabbis of his day is that they all had a trade. They all had an occupation. And I actually want to begin with the Apostle Paul, who is a rabbi himself. And in his second missionary journey, when he arrives at Corinth in Acts 18:3, we have this recorded. "And because Paul was of the same trade, he stayed with Aquila and Priscilla, and they worked together, for they were tent makers by trade." Now, when Paul is teaching the text, he is doing so, you know, at times in a lecture hall, at times in a synagogue, maybe in the marketplace. But when he's not doing that, he is in the leather worker's shop. And I say that specifically because tents were typically made out of leather. Paul comes from Tarsus in Cilicia, world renowned for their textile industry. Paul is probably very proficient in a number of textiles. Chief among them is leather and making tents. So when Paul's not teaching, he's in the shop. Jesus is a little bit different because Paul's ministry was much longer than Jesus's. Jesus's was only 3 to 3.5 years. He has a trade up to the point he begins his ministry, but it seems to be that once Jesus launches headlong into his ministry, he is focusing entirely on teaching the text and raising up his disciples, and he's not engaging with his trade. But what was his trade? What's the family trade? You all know it is that of a carpenter. This is recorded in Mark 6:3. Isn't this the carpenter? Now, the word carpenter is the Greek word tekton. Okay, so let me hear you say tekton. Yeah, I can't hear you, but maybe you said it. All right, so tekton doesn't mean carpenter in how we typically think carpenter. Because when we think carpenter, we think someone who works primarily with wood. That's not the case. The word tekton means a craftsman, a master builder, an artisan, because they're working not just in wood. In fact, they're working more than in wood. They're working in stone. That's the primary building material of Jesus' day in the Galilee region. In fact, if you go to Israel today, you're going to see lots of trees. But as my guide likes to remind me, over 95% of the trees in Israel today have been planted since the early 1900s. In Jesus's day, there's not an abundance of wood. There is an abundance of stone, and everything is made out of stone. So whenever I'm watching kind of a reenactment of the first century world of Jesus's life, and you just see Jesus always making, you know, stools and benches and chairs and carving wood, I chuckle, not because he wouldn't have done that, he would have from time to time, but the primary material with which a tekton works with is stone. And so a better translation would be a craftsman. Isn't this the craftsman? Now, what was the role of a craftsman or a tekton? Well, you are the one who was called in anytime a foundation needed to be built, for a building, for a room in a house, whatever that needed as far as a foundation to be laid, the tekton was the one that was commissioned to do this. And we all know if you don't have a great foundation, everything else is in jeopardy. And so the tekton would arrange the foundation and then instruct the rest of the crew or those who would be building it. So if a son was building on a room to the father's house, to the father's compound for his wedding day, then the tekton would show up, lay the foundation, and then make sure that the son was good to go on building the rest of it. When it came to constructing the doorway, the tekton would come back and would do the doorway because that's tricky. What's trickier is if you actually needed a door to go in that doorway. This is where the wood comes into play. Doors were made out of wood, and we all know that when it's hot, wood swells and doors get stuck. And when it gets cool, doors do not swell, they actually recede, if you will, and now doors can swing open with a light breeze. You don't want that happening. So a tekton was responsible for constructing the doorway, making the door, and then putting the door in the doorway and affixing it with pins, which were typically made out of metal. And if you needed to have a lock put on your door, the tekton would do that as well. And so tektons were really well respected in the community. They had a very high skill set, and they overlapped with the life of everyone, because typically someone had to build something at some time. Now, based on the archaeology of Nazareth being a small village from what we understand archaeologically today, Jesus' family may have been the only tektons in town. But when you have a larger village or you've got a city, you're going to have multiple families of tektons. And this is what Jesus was. Now, Paul Wright, in a short article called Carpenters and Builders in the ESV Archaeology Study Bible, one of the two study Bibles we highly recommend here at Walking the Text, he says this. He says, a good tekton would have been physically strong, creative, competent in applied engineering, good at problem solving, and able to organize, supervise, and lead others. Okay, it took a robust skill set to be an effective tekton. And as a result of this, a tradition developed that got recorded in the Talmudic time period. And so I believe it's being actually referenced in Matthew 13, 55 to 56, the parallel passage to that Mark 6, 3, because whereas Mark just has the audience saying, isn't this the craftsman? It says, isn't this the craftsman's son? Meaning that Joseph was a craftsman, Jesus was a craftsman, and both are referenced there. Now, why did I say that that then developed into some kind of a tradition in the Talmudic time period? Well, the Talmud, which was compiled, the Jerusalem one in 400 AD, the Babylonian one in 500 AD, we talked about this in the very first part of this mini-series of Rabbis and Disciples, is that there is a reference in both the Jerusalem Talmud as well as in the Babylonian Talmud that link a learned scholar, an ordained rabbi, with an artisan, or the word is actually connected to tekton. So in the Talmudic time period, an ordained rabbi was called a skilled artisan, skilled in the teaching of the text, but that artisan word is being drawn from the tekton world. And so the tradition that developed is that if you were of a tekton family, it was understood that you also knew God's word really well and could apply it effectively. So much so that one of the references here in the Talmud is that people are looking for a ruling on something. There's no rabbi around. And so the question is there a tekton, the son of a tekton, that can speak into this? Because the understanding was without a learned scholar, the best thing you have is a tekton. And Jesus is obviously both, but it seems like there's an understanding that that would come a little bit maybe more naturally to the mind of a tekton. At least somehow in some way, this tradition is melded here in the Talmudic time period. Which makes me wonder if there isn't another way of interpreting a very well-known passage when Jesus is at the temple at the age of 12. Now, we looked at this passage a couple of episodes ago, but essentially, Jesus is being asked by his parents after they find him after 3 days, why are you doing this? And Jesus' response is, why is it that you were looking for me? Did you not know that I had to be in my father's house? Now, the word house actually doesn't show up in the Greek. The translation has supplied it. What it literally says in the Greek is, "Did you not know that I had to be in the things of my father?" And those things have been interpreted as being affairs or in the business of my father. That's why some of you have heard Jesus said, "Didn't you know I have to be about my father's business?" And immediately we believe that Jesus is talking about God, as in God the Father in heaven. But that assumes that Jesus had a fully developed understanding that he was the second person of the Trinity who came into human existence through the incarnation, and by the age of 12 knew everything about who he was and what his relationship was. At least that's how many of us think of it. But could it be that when Paul writes in Philippians 2 that Jesus did not leverage his divine qualities so that he could fully live into human existence? Could it be that, yes, Jesus was always divine, but when he set aside his divine traits in order to leverage them in human experience, which Paul says he never did, could it be that he wasn't talking about God the Father in heaven as much as he was talking about his earthly father, Joseph? Meaning that if Joseph had trained Jesus in the text, and again, according to the Talmudic tradition, Tektons were really good with the text, then perhaps Jesus was saying, "Dad, why did you not think I was going to be here? Like, I'm just extending what you have given to me. I am doing the things of my father, you, and I'm growing in my understanding of the text by questioning these religious leaders and scholars here at the temple." Now, we don't know for certain, but it's another way of looking at this. But here's what we can almost be certain of, that based on what parents were responsible for doing as far as raising their kids in the text, Joseph would have been the primary voice in Jesus' life growing up around the text. Joseph may even have been Jesus' rabbi for a time if Joseph had been a rabbi. We know that Jesus grew up in Nazareth, which was just 3.5 miles from Sepphoris. There wasn't a ton of building activity going on in Nazareth in Jesus' day, or at least what we can discern archaeologically. What we do know archaeologically is that there was a massive building program going on at Sepphoris, just 3.5 miles northwest of Nazareth. You see, when Herod the Great died, his son Herod Antipas gained control of Galilee and Perea, which is just off the northeast side of the Dead Sea, and Antipas named Sepphoris as his capital city and had to rebuild the entire city as Jesus was growing up. That is where the work was. And so from an archaeological perspective, you can see that this is just a big site. You've got a theater here. You've got all of these buildings and foundations here. You have an entire city center going that direction. This is where Jesus probably learned the tekton trait of the family. And here's what's so cool for me is to be thinking about Joseph and Jesus leaving Nazareth in the morning, walking those, you know, that hour and a half, that 3.5 miles to Sepphoris, and Joseph is talking text, and then they get to Sepphoris and Joseph is teaching tekton. And then they're walking back home and they're talking and teaching text. And it's like the text and the tectonness are going together. And again, we see that in the Talmudic tradition. But either way you shake it, Joseph is teaching Jesus a trade. He is also teaching Jesus the text. And this is part of how Jesus grew up in the tekton world of both that of a craftsman, but also a man of the text that obviously led to him becoming a rabbi. And so you've got Sepphoris just a short distance away, and this is probably where Jesus and Joseph spent so much time together. Now, here's what's interesting is that Joseph falls off the stage after the scene at the temple that is recorded in Luke chapter 2. Now, when Jesus starts his ministry, we never see anything in connection to Joseph. He's never mentioned. Many people believe that he died before Jesus launched his ministry. And so when Luke tells us that Jesus was 12 at the temple, Luke is precise. He's a details guy. He's a doctor. But when he talks about Jesus launching his ministry at 30, he doesn't say 30. He says in the very next chapter, about 30. And in our next episode, we're going to talk about how rabbis began their ministry or became rabbis at the age of 30. Luke does not say 30, says about 30. Jesus may have been 31. He may have been 32. And I believe that the reason why Luke records about 30 is that he's connecting Jesus into the rabbinical system of the day. But many speculate that Jesus may have spent a little bit more time with his occupation as a tekton in order to provide funds for his mother and the rest of his family, because if Joseph had died, it would fall to the oldest son to provide for the mother and the siblings, and that would have been on Jesus. What's more, Jesus may have worked a little bit extra in order to get finances to help fund his ministry, because once he launches into his ministry, he doesn't seem to go back to his trade. So there's probably a lot of factors at play, and most notably, Jesus only did what the Father told him to do, and when God said it was time for you to start, Jesus would have started. So that's the primary reason right there. But this leads me to a very interesting set of observations that David Bivens made in new light on the difficult words of Jesus when he wrote this. He says, despite the fact that most rabbis had professions, they were not always able to support themselves as they traveled throughout the land. The traveling sage could not easily set up a shop due to the shortness of a stay in any given location, nor would it have been fair when visiting smaller communities to take work away from a local resident in the same profession. Also, work could not readily be found for the large number of disciples who often accompanied a rabbi. Therefore, the rabbi and his disciples were necessarily dependent upon the hospitality of the communities they visited. So when Jesus and his disciples show up, they're living into an itinerant lifestyle, something we'll talk about in the next episode as well, is that they are leaning on the generosity and hospitality of those that they are interacting with in the towns and villages in which Jesus and his disciples go. And so you have hospitality and ministry support being demonstrated in the text. In fact, there's this really interesting reference to the Perkei Avot, which we've actually looked at before, where it says, "Let your house be a meeting place for the rabbis, and cover yourself in the dust of their feet and drink in their words thirstily." That you would come into someone's house, a rabbi would teach, and then not as a way of saying, hey, we want to compensate you for teaching us, but as a way of saying, thank you for teaching us, we would like to support your ministry, they would give funds to the rabbi in his Talmudim. And in John 12, verse 6, John references Judas, and he says, he, talking about Judas, did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. That reference to the money bag seems to be a reference to the money bag that people would put money into in order to provide for the needs of the rabbi and his Talmudim. And John goes, yeah, and Judas was actually stealing from it. Okay, so you see this reference playing out, and you see the hospitality and ministry support in the Gospels, but most notably, you see it here in this last passage I want to look at, Luke 8, 1-3. After this, Jesus traveled about from one town and village to another, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. The 12 were with him, and also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. Mary, called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had come out, Joanna, the wife of Cusa, the manager of Herod's household, Susanna, and many others. These women were helping to support them out of their own means. Now, let's just pause for a moment and take in the humor where it's screaming at us here in the text. So, Herod's household, the reference to Herod here is Herod Antipas, the guy who is ruling Galilee, the guy who killed John the Baptist, Jesus's cousin, the guy who wants to get rid of Jesus and his ministry, the guy in whom Jesus is the only person who he doesn't speak to in the text. Like when Jesus and Antipas are having a conversation, Antipas is the only one doing the teaching or the talking in Jerusalem. Jesus says nothing to him. Okay, this is the only time this happens in the text. And he, Herod, is trying to get rid of Jesus and his ministry, and unbeknownst to him, Herod pays his CFO, who takes his funds home, whose wife then takes those funds and funds the very ministry that Antipas is trying to squelch. It is hysterical. And it's how God works to advance his will and way in the world, and in this case, through Jesus and his disciples. So they would lean on the generosity of those they visited with in towns and villages. They would lean on the support of very wealthy people like these women. What's more is that the families of disciples would often give to the rabbi and the Talmudim to help them as well. So that's how you made it when you couldn't charge for the teaching of God's word, or it was prohibited for you to receive that. And we see that Jesus had a profession, but there was a moment where his profession ceased as a tekton, to be a rabbi who was teaching the text and training his disciples, and doing this from town to town, from village to village. And God provided for their needs through the generosity of others. And so that's how I just want to end this episode, is I just want to say thank you to all of you who have done for us what these folks in the text did for Jesus and his disciples. And not equating walking the text with Jesus and his disciples, but the idea that you make it possible for us to provide these teachings to people completely free of charge. You come alongside, you allow me to do this work, you allow my team to do this work, and we just want to say thank you. Not thank you and, hey, please give to walking the text, just a thank you for investing in this work in order for God's word to go out, so that we can all not only grow in our understanding of God's words, but that we can also grow as disciples of Jesus Christ in the world today. So friends, thanks so much for watching. Thanks for listening. And as always, may you walk out the text well in your life.